Here, look, and I'd like to have the opportunity to comment briefly on the Social Welfare Bill 2017. There are, of course, some welcome measures in the bill before us, which will give legislative effect to the changes announced in Budget 2018. And in order to effect those changes, the Social Welfare Act, Maternity Protection Act 1994, National Training Fund Act 2000 will be amended and extended. And, of course, the government decided to continue with its partial restoration of social protection payments for next year, with €5 increases across most payments. But disappointingly, and in keeping with last year, of course, these partial restorations, Minister, they won't come into effect until the end of March 2018. In my own pre-budget submission to Minister Donoghue Cathaoirleach, I called for a social protection package of approximately €500 million increase in department allocations, which would have included €7 per week increases. In the event the government chose to only increase the social protection budget by less than €300 million, or under 1.5%, and most of the increase is funded, of course, by savings from the fall in unemployment. But I welcome Section 12, as it partially restores the weekly earning disregard for those in receipt of the one-parent family payment from €110 per week to €130 per week. Again, in my own submission, I called for full restoration back to €146.50 per week at an estimated cost of €11.1 million. And in some of your government's cruelest austerity years cuts, Minister, lone parents, of course, were targeted, and the weekly income disregard dropped to a low of €75 per week in 2015 and €60 per week in 2016. Surveys and CSO statistics have been shown for years that lone parent families experienced the highest consistent poverty rates than any other cohort in Irish society. And in the most recent Silk report, this rate was 26.2% for consistent poverty. 57.9% experienced deprivation compared to 25.5% of the rest of the population. And yet the Social Welfare and Pensions Act 2012 further discriminated against lone parents by ceasing payment of the one-parent family payment once the youngest child reached 7 years of age. And at that point, lone parents are switched to job seekers' transitional payment. And while studies show that these draconian so-called reforms did move some parents, lone parents, into employment, the majority of which, of course, is low-paid, part-time and precarious employment, they also led to over 30% of recipients of the new payment losing over 10% of their weekly income. And of course, Minister, losing 10% of your weekly income when you're already in poverty is soul-destroying. And the previous government and this government should have been doing everything in its power to reverse changes that meant that that cohort of Irish families are being pushed further into poverty and consistent poverty. And the Indicon report on those changes were published by your department at the beginning of October 2017. And I'm just wondering, Minister, if you, in your reply, what action are you going to take on foot of that? At the Dáil Budgetary Oversight Committee last week, we had a lengthy briefing and discussion on gender inequality and gender-proofing of budgets into the future. And the committee is, under your colleague Josefa Madigan, is determined to take this issue in the context of budgets, take on this issue in the context of budgets 2018-2019. Now, a key issue I raised again, of course, which my colleague Deputy Collins has just raised once more, were changes made in Budget 2012 to the PRSI contribution bans for the pension, which say pension, which also disproportionately impacted on women. On the 19th of October, of course, the Dáil voted on the motion on correcting pension inequities. And of course, on 21st of February this year, I also raised the topic during leaders' questions with former Taoiseach Kenny and called for a reversal of the Budget 2012 changes and for those affected to be reimbursed. Age Action Ireland's excellent report towards a fair state pension for women pensioners research, which was researched and written by Ms. Maureen Bassett, set out in detail the number of women people impacted by the change of from four bands to six, and highlighted that almost two-thirds of those affected pensioners were and continue to be women. And many people reaching pension age, of course, are not even aware of these changes and are often shocked, upset and angry when they really realise what was done. I'm sure you've found that yourself, Cathaoirleach, in your information clinics around Kildare. But even more so when they learned that the government of the day had been warned that such changes would disproportionately affect women, women who had little or no childcare supports while rearing their families, and so had no choice but to stop working in many cases. So while the €5 increase in weekly pension rates this year and last are of course welcome, there are many who would think that those underhanded austerity year changes should be reversed and that pension inequity should indeed be corrected. And we've heard your own comments on this, Minister. You clearly think it was a crazy decision, although you voted for it. Now you're in the ministerial office in the department and you have the opportunity to reverse it and to ensure that those women whom I meet week in, week out, who've lost €30 or €40 due to those changes for the rest of their lives, that we do bring them justice. And I think that would be a good ambition maybe for the rest of your administration. Another important point on equality, of course, is the continued discrimination of those citizens under 26 in their lower rates of job seekers. And while this year they're receiving the full €5 weekly increase, they're still receiving far less than other job seekers. And young citizens aged 18 to 24 years will receive JSA of only €107 a week, even after this bill is passed. And again, in my own submission, I'd call for an increase of €30 per week for all under 26s at a cost of €24 million. I think the government narrative, of course, that young people all live at home with their mammies and daddies to pay their rent and buy them food is completely disrespectful for those who haven't, who don't have that safety net and who are trying to afford city rents while looking for jobs. And this year we saw a huge increase in homelessness, of course, in the 18 to 24-year-old age group. Section 3 of the bill, of course, amends the definition of share-based remuneration because of the introduction of the Key Employee Engagement Programme, the KEEP programme, announced in the budget. However, reports are suggesting, Minister, that this share option, while initially welcome, will now have a minimal positive impact for employees of many innovative business sectors. I welcome, of course, sections 4, 5 and 6, which increase the rates of maternity, paternity and adoptive benefit to €240. Section 8, of course, renames family income supplement to working family payment. And this renaming comes into effect from the 1st of January 2018. But the new income thresholds of €521, €622 and €723 don't come into operation at the end of March. So once again, I note, as indeed with the very changed name and function of your department, Employment and Social Protection, we always seem to follow, it reminds me of Work and Pensions, Minister, we always seem to follow British models with regard to necessary social protection supports. In fact, we renamed virtually all of our social protection supports after what the British were doing, but yet we would be bitterly opposed, of course, to the approach, austerity approach of successive Tory governments over there. I note anyway that the number of FIST recipients has now risen to almost 56,000 families from 22,000 a decade ago. And it's also good to see, Minister, that you extended the back-to-work dividend beyond March 31. Section 14 is a welcome provision and should have been introduced long ago, providing for the payment of maternity benefit in cases of premature birth. And Section 16 in Part 3 amends Section 4 of the National Treatment Fund 2000 to provide for the increase to 0.8%, which will come into effect on 1 January 2018. And this levy, of course, is set to increase annually down to 0.9% in 2019 and 1% in 2020. I had called for it, Minister, to be increased to 1% from 2018, which would yield a much-needed £200 million for third-level funding. And you might remember Taoiseach for Adhocar, he refused to indicate to me on a leader's question not too long ago whether or not he has made a decision about loans, about student loans, because this obviously is a major feature of funding third-level education. Of course, the Minister's Department, it is our largest in terms of expenditure, with 32.8% of our total expenditure, although, as you know, half that expenditure we sort of fund ourselves through our social insurance, more than half indeed. And I understand the level of transactions underway at the department is staggering. Of course, I think you told us that before, Ministers, that figures from 2015 report show that 1.6 million people received a payment, 1.7 million applications were processed, and 8.3 million telephone calls were answered. And that's very impressive. But I do want to raise a few issues around the way in which the Department of Social Protection works. The length of time for processing applications and appeals, it remains far too long for many payments. As a volunteer director myself of community projects and organisations, I have first-hand experience of the requirements around employing community employment participants, and I have noticed the frustrations of our staff and management in navigating what seems to me to be an ever more complicated system. So are the plans to move your department towards a more user-friendly system, and do you have the personnel resources? We just heard from Minister Flanagan earlier that the Department of Justice seemed to be down by a third of its staff, so I just wonder what the situation is in relation to your department. One last issue I want to raise is the interpretation of the exceptional needs. I've been contacted by an outstanding lawyer in my constituency who highlighted that the Department of Social Protection staff are recently stating that in order to approve an exceptional needs payment, that the need must also be, and I quote, unforeseen. And you told me that, Minister, on the 7th November last. You said, under supplementary welfare allowance, I'm quoting you, the Department may make a single exceptional needs payment to help meet essential once-off and unforeseen expenditure which a person could not reasonably be expected to meet out of their weekly income. And you said you provided £31.5 million. But however, as the barrister who raised the issue with me says, if a person's mother is ill and dying for a number of months, the funeral costs may indeed be exceptional and not unforeseen. And issues like this are arising DSP offices, definitely around Dublin, but probably also in other areas of the country. So exception needs is one area I'd also like you to look at. I wanted to mention very briefly also that in my own submission I included a request that perhaps a pilot basic income programme should be proceeded with in order to see how feasible it would be to introduce the basic income on a larger scale. We know that Finland, I think, and maybe one or two other countries are experimenting with that. As always, of course, I want to mention very briefly the Social Insurance Fund, which last year stood at just under 11 billion. I understand the fund is now back in surplus, and I'd like the Minister, perhaps in her reply, maybe to tell us what's the current standing of the fund and what's the contribution. And looking at the fund, have you any plans to expand the range of benefits available, especially to workers and their families? So in general, Cathaoirleach, and thanks for the little extra, I welcome some of the partial restorations provided for in this bill, but I believe the government has the resources to do much more, especially in the area of gender and disability equality proofing. Thanks.
Thank you, Deputy.